Human beings are a product of evolution. We are a species just like all the others, whether we want to acknowledge that or not. And one of the things that has given us is an instinctive response that economists have actually formalized in the concept of discounting. There was tremendous survival value in a kind of short-sighted selfishness. So if you can imagine a band of hunter-gatherers who are a little bit hungry, and let's say they find a tree with just a few more apples than they can eat right now. I'm using a trivial example, but it's easy to understand. So they feed, and there's a few left, which they could leave and wander off, and they've been personally sated. But if they did that, they would not benefit from those remaining fruit. You could call them buffalo, whatever, you get my point. And if they move on, maybe somebody else is going to get those fruit. So there's an advantage to them in taking it with them or overconsuming, having a big feed right now and getting fat and lazy and making damn sure that nobody else acquires those assets. So what we tend to do is discount the future. We tend to prefer the here and now over future and distant places. It's a natural tendency that had huge survival value in the past. Okay? So what we do when confronted with a decision that would say sacrifice pleasures we are enjoying today, such as enjoying my automobile or my fast or my big house or whatever it might be, if I sacrifice that in order to enjoy a possible benefit in the future, and it's only possible because, people will say the science is uncertain, we really don't know what's going to intervene, and maybe I'll be dead before the future arrives and all of that sort of thing. Why would I do that? Why would I give up something now to gain something maybe in the future, some unspecified future benefit, such as climate stability? So that's one thing. We have a natural tendency to prefer the here and now over future events. And economists call this discounting, so that we tend to underestimate the impact of future costs, or for that matter, benefits, on our lifestyles today. Another thing is called the public good problem. Supposing I understand profoundly that my lifestyle is having a three or four-fold larger impact on the planet than is, first of all, fair and equitable, and that much larger than the Earth could actually sustain, even if everybody had a much smaller footprint. And suppose I therefore adapted my lifestyle so that I was conforming exactly to what the Earth could handle. So I'd have to reduce, say, from 6 hectares down to 1.5 hectares. So that's about so what, 75% or more drop in the total amount of consumption that I can enjoy in my time on Earth. Now, what I've done in doing that is made a huge personal, well, most of us would see it as a huge personal sacrifice, because we couldn't have our gasoline-powered cars. We couldn't use coal or natural gas to heat our homes and generate our electricity and so on and so forth. So we'd be making an enormous sacrifice in order to improve the global environment. And so in a sense, I'd be creating what economists would call, again, a public good. But by creating that public good, I pay the entire cost. And my share of the benefits, assuming nothing else happens, my share of the benefit would be immeasurable, unmeasurable. And because my benefit of my cutting back is so infinitesimally small compared to the planet that nobody would even notice. So I make a huge personal sacrifice for an extremely tiny share of any benefit. And by the way, the benefit doesn't get realized anyway, because as soon as I vacate that space, somebody else takes it up. You see what I'm saying? All of it has created the space for three or four more people in the developed world, or another person, my neighbor, to get a bigger car and a bigger house and all the rest of it. So there's very little kind of psychological incentive for individuals to act now, because A, they won't gain much anyway, even if nobody else did anything. And there's always this sense that other people are still pushing and consuming and wanting more and growing and having children, and the population is still increasing. So why should I give up anything in order to gain nothing? And that's I think, a very powerful argument that people use. So in many respects, we're caught both between our instincts to use now and consume as much as we can in the short time that we're on the planet, and this sense that if we didn't do it, somebody else will anyway. So those are just some of the reasons that are flying in our face.
Right.
There's another problem here. We are a species. This was a difficult one for many people to understand because they think they're living in reality. But we don't actually communicate with reality. Human beings, every culture socially constructs its perceptions of reality. And then we act out of that reality as if it were true. Mm. So, if you went back, say, 700 years and I said, hey, the world is flat, nobody's going to dispute. Of course it's flat. Everybody can see that.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have a common perception of reality that the world is flat. It's completely wrong, but we all agree that the world is flat. And by the way, you could live your life back then as if the world were flat and it wouldn't make any difference. So you're dead wrong and it doesn't make any difference. The sun rises in the east. Well, we all agree with that. But in fact, of course, the sun doesn't rise in the east. It's a social construct that explains things the way we see them, but the way we see them is a delusion or an illusion created by our sensory apparatus. The fact is, of course, that the Earth is rotating on its axis, and in relative terms, the sun is in a stationary state. And so the sun's not rising in the east, the Earth is simply rotating under it. Mm-hmm. And yet what we perceive is what we take to be real. Now, that happens in every domain of human understanding. Every discipline in our academic institutions, economics, biology, physics, chemistry, all of these are social constructs. Everything we've learned in those disciplines are social constructs. Every political ideology, capitalism, neoliberal economics, all of these things, communism, these are social constructs, mm-hmm. a set of beliefs. Each of them is a separate set of beliefs, values, and assumptions about the nature of reality, about the nature of the economy, about the nature of society, and so on and so forth. Religious doctrines, whether it's Judaism or Christianity or Islam, all of these are stories made up by human beings, but believed in profoundly by their acolytes, the people who subscribe to each of those stories. So even though human beings make up the realities from which they live, all right, please understand me, mm-hmm. everybody lives out of a disciplinary paradigm or a political ideology or a religious doctrine. In fact, we live out of all of those things simultaneously. It's all made up stories mm-hmm. that may or may not correspond to the nature of some important aspect of reality. So we're a very weird species mm-hmm. insofar as we socially construct the realities out of which we act, and those realities may or may not fit the planet in which we live. So just to give a very concrete example, right now the world is largely being dominated and run by an economic paradigm called neoliberal economics. And its fundamental underpinnings, by the way, it's the economics of capitalism, mm-hmm. are that we can grow forever, that the economy can grow forever, money is just an abstract concept after all, and that the human ingenuity is our greatest resource, because through technology, we can always substitute for nature or find resources that didn't previously exist, and so there are no constraints on the human enterprise. Well, that's a model of reality. It's the one out of which the world economy is operating. And yet that model, and indeed all of the models of neoliberal economics, none of them contain any profoundly useful information about the structure or the biophysical dynamics of the ecosystems with which the economy interacts in the real world. So we're really operating out of a model of reality that does not map to the biophysical reality within which the economy operates. And then we tend to be surprised as to why everything is screwing up. It's just an incredible, naive situation in many respects, and yet that's the way we are. And I could go on like this for hours, because there's dozens of other reasons why human beings simply don't pay any attention on the whole to the nature of reality as our science tells us, because it would interfere with the nature of reality that we've created as a means of lifestyle, as an economic paradigm, and so on and so forth. We do not like, that's a whole other thing. Human beings are habitual creatures. So once we've established a habitual pattern that is familiar, that's comfortable, once we've socially constructed expectations that everything is going to get better, and when you map that to the fact that we are natural optimists, you know, anybody who's born a total pessimist probably wouldn't survive very long. So we're naturally optimistic. When you tie our natural optimism to socially constructed paradigms of infinite growth and the technology will save us, then it takes a huge amount of evidence to make a dent in our actual behavior. So the bottom line, Patrick, is that humans tend to behave much more out of their instincts and their emotional attachments to socially constructed realities. We behave much more according to those things than we do to raw, crude scientific data that says the climate is changing, the fish stocks are dying, the planet is being eroded under our feet. We just want to shy away from those kinds of things. I'll give you one more, because I think it really is important. I've already emphasized that we socially construct our realities. What cognitive neuroscience tells us today is that once you've heard a particular idea, or once a particular thought pattern is repeated over and over and over again, it actually acquires a physical structure in the brain. So that thinking a particular way habitually creates neural networks, synaptic circuitry, that reflects or embeds in the brain that pattern of thinking. And once you have that ingrained in your mind, and by the way, again, think religious ideology, or rather religious doctrine or political ideology or academic paradigm. Once that patterned way of thinking is there, human beings have a natural tendency to seek out other people who think and believe the same way, and to immerse themselves in experiences that reinforce their pre-existing neural pathways. So we learn through the social construction of reality to create reliable social pathways or neural networks in our brains and then stick to them. And once we've got these embedded ways of thinking in our heads, we tend to deny, forget, or ignore contrary information. So you can see reason after reason piled one after the other reinforces a tendency of a kind of behavioral conservatism when it comes to facing up to the realities of our ecological dilemma. It has to do with biology, it has to do with social paradigm, it has to do with our economic beliefs, and it has to do with the cognitive biology, which was once very adaptive. Keep in mind that, you know, again, 10,000 years ago, it probably was highly adaptive for an individual to learn the myths, the stories, the cultural norms of their little tribe, because that gave you a sense of belonging. It gave you a sense of security. It caused tribal cohesion, social cohesion. So all of these patterns, which are currently maladaptive, that are driving us to the brink of extinction potentially, used to be highly adaptive. And that's because they evolved in a very different set of environmental circumstances, when human populations were small, when technology had no impact, and when humans had almost no influence whatsoever on their environments. It was okay to become, entrained in a particular set of beliefs, values, assumptions, and myths, and so on. It created group security and gave one a sense of identity. Today, those same qualities in a crowded planet that is writhing in agony because of the overuse by human beings, these things have become maladaptive because it blinds us to the seriousness of our own situation.